Welcome to the second week of this massive open online course on PL/SQL Fundamentals. You are viewing the second video of this week using SQL statements in PL/SQL programs. By now, Jill is convinced that PL/SQL is a good solution for maintaining and processing employee data in the HR database. As you already know, Jill has a requirement to validate each new employee's salary range as per his or her job title before inserting a new record in the employees table. Jill now starts thinking of implementing this requirement using PL/SQL. One option before Jill is to query the salary range for the job title of each new employee from the jobs table and pass it on as a parameter to the PL/SQL block for salary validation. But do you think it is an efficient approach to execute a SQL query and invoke the validation logic in PL/SQL block for each new employee record? Do you wonder if there is any possibility to retrieve the salary range for a job title within the PL/SQL block itself as and when required? Doesn't it make Jill's job even easier? Yes, absolutely. You can execute SQL statements directly within a PL/SQL block. So, in the current scenario, Jill can read the salary range data from the jobs table, validate the new employee's salary using this data, and even insert the new employee's record into the employee's table from the PL/SQL block itself. This sounds great, isn't it? Getting into further details, let us now see which SQL statements can be executed directly from a PL/SQL block. You can use SQL statements to retrieve data from the database tables like SELECT in a PL/SQL block. You can also use data manipulation language commands like INSERT, UPDATE and DELETE in a PL/SQL block to modify the data in the database tables. PL/SQL also supports transaction control commands like COMMIT, ROLLBACK or SAVEPOINT. However, you cannot directly execute any data definition language commands like CREATE, ALTER, DROP from a PL/SQL block. PL/SQL does not directly support data control language statements such as grant or revoke. However, you can use dynamic SQL to execute them in a PL/SQL block. If you like to know more about dynamic SQL, please go to the link given in the YouTube video description. Let us now see the syntax for using SELECT statement in a PL/SQL block. SELECT, SELECT list, which is a list of one or more columns to be retrieved from the database, into one or more variable names to hold the retrieved values, or record name which can hold all the retrieved values together as a record, from table where condition. The condition can have column names, expressions, constants and comparison operators. Let us now look at a few guidelines for using SELECT statements within PL/SQL block with the help of an example. Terminate each SQL statement with a semicolon. SELECT list can include SQL expressions, row functions, or group functions. Every value retrieved must be stored in variable by using the INTO clause. The WHERE clause is optional and can be used to specify input variables, constants, literals, and PL/SQL expressions. Specify the same number of variables in the INTO clause as the number of database columns in the SELECT clause. Be sure that they correspond positionally and that their data types are compatible. SELECT statements within a PL/SQL block must return only one row. A query that returns more than one row or no row generates an error. PL/SQL manages these errors by raising standard exceptions, which you can handle in the exception section of the block with the no data found and too many rows exceptions. Therefore, include a WHERE condition in the SQL statement so that the statement returns a single row. You will learn about exception handling in the MOOC titled PL/SQL Program Units. I am sure you might be wondering if there is any possibility to retrieve multiple rows from a table and process that data in a PL/SQL block. Yes, it is possible, with the help of explicit cursors. They allow you to process each row returned by the SELECT statement. An explicit cursor actually points to a SQL private area where all the rows returned by the select statement are stored temporarily. You can fetch each record from the cursor into a set of PLSQL variables or a single PLSQL record or any other PLSQL composite data types for processing. For now, we will not get into its details, and it will be discussed in the lesson titled Working with PLSQL Cursors in week 3 of this course. Shall we get into SQL Developer and execute few select queries now? In this example, the v_emp_hireDate and v_emp_salary variables are declared in the declarative section of the PLSQL block. In the executable section, the values of the hire_date and salary columns for the employee with the employee_ID 100 are retrieved from the employees table. Next, they are stored in the v_emp_hireDate and v_emp_salary variables respectively. Observe how the into clause along with the select statement retrieves the database column values and stores them in the PLSQL variables. Let us run the script now and see the results. Now let's see how to use group functions in the select list of a select query executed in a PLSQL block. In this example, the v_sum_sal and v_deptnvo variables are declared in the declarative section of the PLSQL block. In the executable section, the total salary for the employees in the department with department_id 60 is computed using the SQL aggregate function sum. The calculated total salary is assigned to the v_sum_sal variable. Note that group functions cannot be used in PLSQL syntax. They must be used in SQL statements within a PLSQL block. Before concluding this topic, let's look at an important aspect called naming ambiguities. Can you look at this example and guess its output? As per the logic, it must retrieve the hire date from the employees table for employee ID 176 along with the system date and store them in the local variables. But when you execute this script, it actually throws an unhandled runtime exception. Can you guess why? This is because the local variable hire_date declared in the declarative section is exactly same as one of the column names in the employees table. Another local variable is declared as sysDate, which is actually a PLSQL date function. In the where clause, the PLSQL variable names are the same as the database column names in the employees table. All these create confusion to the PLSQL in identifying the variables. This is called naming ambiguity. How can we prevent naming ambiguities? Number 1. By always using a naming convention in the where clause. For example, prefixing all the local variables with v_ to distinguish them from database table columns. So, the corrected code will be as shown on the screen. Number 2. By avoiding use of database column names as identifiers. Let us also have a look at the approach followed by PLSQL to resolve the variables in case of a naming ambiguity. The names of local variables and formal parameters take precedence over the names of database tables. The names of database table columns take precedence over the names of local variables. The names of variables take precedence over function names. We have come to the end of the lesson, and now it's time for a quick recap. In this lesson, you learned which SQL statements can be executed within PLSQL block and how to retrieve data using a select statement. You were also introduced to naming ambiguities. In the next lesson, you will learn about executing DML statements within PLSQL blocks. To practice what you learned, you can solve the assignment posted on OLL course page. It is suggestible to solve the assignment before viewing the next lesson for better understanding. Please post your questions, if any, in the course forum whose link is shown here. Thank you for watching this video. Have a great day ahead.